shaken before the round, and we see that Esipenko against Magnus is off, and 1d4 is on the board.
Okay, that was a Sicilian a year ago. So seeing d4 on one, perhaps Andre is choosing a move repertoire, or he's avoiding specific preparation. My commentary before, where I suggest like a throwaway move, and then I'm like, wait a second, that's actually really interesting. And it happened in the World Cup when Magnus was playing against Wojtacek. I was like, oh, and if this move is played, and that exact sequence happened, and I was commentating with Ben, and Ben's like, even when you blunder, it's a good move. And I was like, I don't know what just happened. That was extraordinarily random. But here, it's hard not to repeat for Magnus because d4 is the main idea that Black is going for. But with the rook on c6, not playing d4, and you do have to be concerned that your position just collapses.
And there is the handshake from c7 accompanied buy and draw offer, which was instantly accepted by Andrey Esipenko, and there we see the post-mortem. So a different image this year. Last year there was the image of Magnus leaving and Andrey sitting at the board in disbelief. But this result also a very solid start to the tournament for Esipenko. Robert, what did you make of the game?
It was solid. I mean, Esipenko is a growing player. He's only 19 years old, and he's over 2,700. A draw against Magnus Carlsen, that's probably a good result. I think one could say that. But don't get Esipenko wrong. He didn't come into this game thinking, oh, I just want to make a draw. He wants to play, and he felt that Magnus had equalized, and he didn't see a way that he could play safely for an advantage, and thus repeated the move. So they just were talking about, the move was actually played on the DGT board. So like, oh, what if I played knight b6 in the final position? But ultimately, Magnus decided it's not worth the risk.